The Diamond Sutra. Meditation leads to experiment. Meditation is an experiment into unknown realm. You know the functioning of the mind. Meditation is an experiment into the unknown realm. If you observe the mind, you will know how a person will interact or react in a particular circumstance and situation. When you transcend the mind, how can you transcend the mind? Mind operates through its subordinates. It is easier to understand that way. Mind has organs of perception, the eyes. Eyes bring information. The ears bring another information. And if you happen to touch the person who you are listening to, it brings another stimuli or impression. All these are gathered. Then a decision is made. Guru Nanak has used a particular line. He says, Panch Parvan, five organs of perception, Panch Pardhan, five organs of action, Pancha ka Guru ek Dhyan, and who is the master of these five organs of perception and five organs of action? It is meditation. So when you start looking at the things or hearing things differently, normally your ears, put it this way, your ears are physical ears, but there is a subtle aspect of hearing which is deeper than the normal hearing. You can look at a particular circumstance and situation through the physical eye. Of course, you look at the physical eye, but behind the physical eye, there is a conditioning that allows you to look in a particular style, particular format, particular manner. If you are conditioned in a particular way, then your viewing will be guided by that. Your hearing will be guided by that. And normally everyone's, this is what becomes the mind, your conditioning. Everyone has their own way of looking at the things, and this distorts the things. There is an example which I give again and again, and I love this very much. There was a beautiful hill station, a place where people go in summer for spending their holidays. It was a tourist resort. There was beautiful hills, and between the hills there was a waterfall, a lovely scene, and far away you can see the snow-capped mountain. So it happened, three friends went. One of them happened to be a poet, next one was an architect, and third was a politician. It is a strange combination of friends: poet, a politician, and an architect, but I put them in one category as friends. For the purpose of my explanation, and each one of them were asked to give their views. So the poet was the first one. He said, what a beautiful example of nature's beauty. Nature has converged here in its pristine beauty. Fresh and beyond description. Seeing this, my poetic heart begins to soar in the sky. I could stay here alone and compose inspiring poetry. Next was the opportunity for the architect. Architect said, "What a beautiful example of nature's architect. No one has done it. And yet you look at the mountain peaks on the two sides, in between a waterfall. If this has to be created by human efforts, it is almost impossible." Third was the opportunity for the politician to express his views. And politicians are of a low intelligence. They can only think in one way, no variation. So he said, "What a criminal waste of nature's resources. Had it been in my constituency, I could have won the election." This is conditioning. This is how the human mind operates. So the politician cannot see the beauty. This is how we operate. This is your physical mind. When you begin to transcend the mind, you get a different vision, a non-conditional. If you are conditioned in a Muslim way or a Hindu way or a Christian way, your expressions will be guided by that. It is better to be a human being first, then anything else, than a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian. It is much better and a benediction to be a human being, because that is how you were born. But the conditions were imposed, conditionings were imposed, and you developed your mind as a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian. When the conditionings begin to dissolve, you enter into an unknown realm, a dimensionless dimension. Then your vision, your hearing becomes of a different nature. You can hear all that is not said. You can hear the unheard. You can see that which is beyond the human vision. And this is why most of the Hindu prayers are based on these two things. In one of the sutras, which is in praise of the elephant god Ganesh, it says, Ganesh Atharva Shish. Shish means the thousand petal center it refers to. Atharva is the sage who envisioned these sutras. It begins with the prayer. The sage in the beginning is invoking the power of hearing and power of seeing, which is beyond the known. Bhadram means, we use the Bhadra, means the gentleman of the highest quality, Bhadra Purush. Bengalis use this word very much, Bhadra Purush, Bhadra Mahila, means a woman of a high quality, a man of high quality. Bhadram Karnibhi, Karn means the ears. May I hear from the ears that which is auspicious, that which is beyond the physical conditionings. I am not hearing it from the Hindu mind or Christian mind or a Jew's mind. I am simply hearing it as a human being. May I hear it as a human being. Bhadram karanebhi shrunyam, may I hear that which is auspicious, that which is transforming, and may I also hear that which is not spoken. The words you hear in one way, I am speaking, words are flowing, you hear the words through the physical hearing, but that which is not said, that which silence communicates, it because the music is a combination of sound and silence, I am speaking, it is the music, it is the rhythm, it is the silence which assumes the form of music. The inner silence is assuming the form of music and overflowing through the vocal cord. So it is sound and silence combined together. The silence that remains between the two words and the silence that it creates into your being while listening to these words. These are ordinary words. And when these words overflow through a particular medium, through a particular realm, which Sufis call tawajjuh, from what plane of consciousness the master is speaking, the effect of that is translated into the silence, and that is also reaching. So may I hear that which is auspicious, so that you can hear the word and the wordless. The sound and the silence, you are hearing it simultaneously. And then the second line comes in, Pashyame aksharabhi yajatra. May I see that which is auspicious. May I see that which is auspicious. Eyes open in the physical world of objects and beings. We see things which we are not supposed to see. But we do not see that which is not seen by the ordinary vision. So these two things are very important. Once these are corrected, everything else begins to move in a different way. And then it invokes various energy fields or energies in the form of deities. And this is how the prayer begins. When we visit a particular shrine of the Sheikh, we must remember the attributes or the teachings of that Sheikh. What was his field of operation, and the as far as the energy level was concerned, we pay our regards, and for paying our regards, we use Surah Fatiha, which is one of the most auspicious prayer to be offered at the shrine of a Sheikh. It begins to prepare you in a different way. So for meditation, no belief is needed, and you do not have to have any concept of God. It becomes an obstruction. If you do believe in the existence of soul, it cannot become an obstruction. Even if you are suspicious about it, you can experiment. Because science, in order to do the experiment, it makes a hypothesis. And then it starts working through the experiment. Maybe that hypothesis that science has created in the beginning of the experiment may prove to be right or may prove to be wrong. The two options are open. It is not prejudiced. While you are experimenting, you are not prejudiced. When it comes to philosophy, you are prejudiced in a particular way. Even if you are suspicious, you can experiment with meditation. Because meditation is simply the art of going within. How you go within? The best example of that is taking an onion and peeling its layers. When you go on peeling the layers and one after the other layers are being removed, now you have to remove the last layer. As you remove the last layer, what do you get? Nothing except the empty space. There was an empty space which was surrounded by various layers of onion. So what was onion? Was the empty space within or the layers? In fact, the two together, the empty space within and the layers upon layers that comprise to give it a form or a shape. This is how the mind is. The mind is an empty space. Around that, in the process of upbringing, we create various layers. Layers of religion, layers of belief system, layers of upbringing and many other conditions. And then we get a mind, onion-like mind. So when you begin the process of meditation, you start removing the layers one after the other. So this is how you are going within. It matters not whether there is soul or not. How can you go in the mind, in the various layers? The first and the foremost layer is, I am a man. Now, is your body decides that you are a man or your being? The space is, if I put it, the space within is your real identity. You may call it soul, you may call it room, whatsoever you may call it. Is that you? Then it cannot be male or female. It is beyond the gender. The space that defines your house or the space that defines the onion is beyond the gender. Then you are identified by the name, and along with the name other things comes. You consider that you come from a high clan or a high social status. I ask someone, what is your name? My name is Dr. So-and-so. Is doctor your name? No, doctor is a degree that has been conferred upon you by way of your education. It is your profession. It is not your name. Name is for identification. You can say, I am known by this name. People know me. And it is said, and those who have experience of male-female relation, they know that husband and wife address one another by different names, depending on the expression at the moment of thought expression. Sometimes you feel very loving, other times you have other emotions onto the surface. So you address the person differently. You can call me by any name. Once I know you are calling me, I will respond. It does not matter whether you call Mr. Mr. is not my name. Sat is not my name. You can call, if you call Jesus as Mr. Jesus, do you think, does it not sound there is something wrong? Or you call Mr. Muhammad. Mr. Muhammad is a worldly person and the holy prophet. You do not need any suffix or prefix with his name. You do not call Ram, but just the moment you say Ram, it gives a different a closeness. When you address your beloved by the first name or initials, it creates a different kind of relationship, a different kind of communication. So you know this. You are not this, you are not that, you are not a doctor. Doctor is a degree by way of your profession that you have to work and live in the world. Your name, your form, and slowly you will reach to the innermost core where you will realize you are an empty space. There is nothing else. And that empty space is your real identity. So one thing in the process, it does not matter whether there is God or not. What is important is that you are. When I wrote the first book, Mditation, the Way to Self-Realization, in the preface I said, do not ask the philosophical questions if God is or not. It does not matter to me whether God exists or not. I can forget about him. But you are. You can be transformed. And you have come because you need transformation. You need to know your real identity. It does not matter to me. Do not ask a question, why did Ram abandon Sita? It is not important in the process of your development. It is not important for you to know what was the relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene. Once it happened during one of the meditation sessions, one of the person asked, can you tell me what was the relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene? I said, yes, I can tell you. So he had asked this question from many people, but people gave the philosophical answers. Your question, your answer given to the person should pacify the questioning mind. Why does a question arise? That should be responded. I continued the talk, and then all of a sudden, when I noticed that the person's attention was not there, I wanted to catch him at the moment to see his awareness. I said, in a normal terminology, I was not around when Jesus and Mary Magdalene were having their affairs, the so-called. Because of that, you have asked this question, what was the relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene? I was not around, so I don't know what was going on between them. It happened after many, many years. One day I met Jesus in the market. So I put my hand, I recognized him, I put my hand over his shoulder and asked him, what was going on between you and Mary Magdalene? So I said, he looked at me a little angrily. He said, you are asking me that question? You mind your business. This is a private affair. People are concerned about the matters of the other people and forget about theirs. You should look into your life. That should be your concern, not what others are doing. Whatever others are doing, they are responsible for it. and there is no need to interfere in the affairs of the other people. Is it not necessary that the message of Jesus is transforming and important? In the presence of Jesus, something has happened to Mary Magdalene, and she was transferred, she was purified. Are you concerned with what was going on, what was the relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene? Even if I say the relationship was between the two was that of master and disciple, your questioning mind will raise the next question. Whatsoever I say, so it's better to shut the person asking certain questions, but in doing so, you have to be very humorous and speak in such a way that it does not offend, instead it attacks the questioning mind. So one thing is certain, that you are, and my main concern is you, because you can be transformed, and the day you are blossomed, the flower has blossomed, its beauty and fragrance will begin to spread, and that time you will not be interested in knowing the questions which comes to the mind of the bud. The bud is very anxious, what will happen when I become a flower? How does a bud become a flower? The bud is very anxious about it. But the moment the bud becomes a flower, all questions, all anxiety vanish. It is important through the presence that I am, the energy field that is being created, the bud of your being begins to blossom and it becomes a flower. The moment it becomes a flower, its beauty and fragrance cannot be contained by any means. It must spread. And it is available for those, only those who are vulnerable. If your attention goes on the thorns, then you will be worried. How can there be a flower when there are so many thorns? But the other, once your vision of looking at the things changes, then you will see. And both thorns and the flower are getting nourishment from the same branch. You can say, thorns are there to protect the flower. The dialectics continues, the pair of opposites. And it is between the pair of opposites, you have to see the transcendence. When the negative and the positive pole of the current interact with one another and they are of the same intensity, they neutralize one another, your bulb lights. The positive energy comes from the existence or from God in the form of light. Just as your electric current, the positive current, comes from the national grid from outside. And through the channel it passes through the various parts of your building or the structure. And the negative comes from the source itself. And when the two neutralize one another, all of a sudden illumination happens. So what it is important, I am giving you that vision. I am trying to create that ambience that the flower of your being begins to blossom. The bulb that needed the current, that needed that energy field so that it can illumine. And that is what my rule is. Once that happens and the light comes into your dark cave, you are wise enough, you are intelligent enough to start putting the things in the right perspective. And if you do not do that, then you do not need to be called yourself a human being. A human being means the moment you realize that this is not how it's supposed to be, you can start putting the things in the right place. And that is all that matters. But who you are? The discovery to this question leads to meditation or leads to marakba. Marakba means waiting for that energy to come in so that you can start the process of transformation, a process of correcting everything around you. This requires experimenting. You start going within. It makes a momentary experience. Maybe you are not external. Maybe you may vanish into death. There is no condition to believe in. Only you have to start the process of experimenting. And the moment you start the process of experimenting, slowly and slowly, you begin to move within. There comes a 180-degree turn, and that is where you realize that in the process of experimenting, you start going within. It may be a momentary experience. Maybe you are not external. Maybe you may vanish into death. There is no condition to believe in. Only you have to start experimenting. Just begin it. Try. Just try and one day it will happen. You will reach to a state when no thoughts are there. Suddenly when you are so much lost into something, you realize that you become oblivious of the outer world. A noise may happen on the street. It does not disturb you. It is like this if you are lost into the love of the beloved. You forget about all other. You have gone for a honeymoon. You have entered the room. You are now to begin your process of honeymoon. All of a sudden, a knock at the door. You say, who is there to disturb? You open the door out of courtesy. Excuse me, sir, the manager sent a bouquet of flowers for you. Because it is a customary in that hotel, whosoever comes from honeymoon, they are given complimentary things, and that's the way they attract the tourists to come to that. So after he took the flowers, the bouquet of flowers, rested on the center table, again prepares himself, all of a sudden another knock. Again, what's it? Disturbance. I have put the do not disturb outside on the door, and yet still, okay, maybe you must look at it. So you look at it. Sir, the manager has sent a basket of fruits for you as complimentary. Okay, thank you very much. And you again close the door and start the process. Then a third knock comes in. Sir, manager sent for you a complimentary wine. These are the things that are normally sent as complimentary for gift. A bottle of wine, a bouquet of flowers, a basket of fruits. But manager arranges these from different sources. So everyone will bring their gifts, their complimentary to be given to the guest separately. But during all these things, your mind is not diverted from your main theme. If you are lost in the love of your beloved, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or God, or whatsoever be your form, you will realize that nothing disturbs you. You have, just as the person has gone out, collected the things and started back his process, there is no disturbance. A state comes in when there is no disturbance, no thought, and then a state comes when there is no thought. Suddenly, when there is no thought, you realize you are separate from the body. Just as a moment comes when the inner jelly of the coconut separates from its outer shell. Right now your mind and the room, they are embedded into one another, they cannot be separated. The moment light comes in and maturity happens, and you can realize that you can separate your mind from the being, from the light, from the root that you are. And then there comes a bridge. Your awareness, your understanding, your tawajjo becomes a bridge that connects the mind and the body, the connection which was not there. Thoughts create the bridge. Thoughts establish a link between the body and the mind. Now suddenly the link is not there anymore, but you are there. The body is there, but now there exists an infinite abyss between the body and the mind. There has been a maturity, the body and the mind is separate. This is the state of fana. The drop dissolves into the ocean, and as Mirza Ghalib says, Ishrate katra hai darya mein fana hona. It is my free will to dissolve into the vastness of the ocean. No one, he could have used it is my fitrat, he could have used any other word, but he uses a word very distinctively. Ishrate katra hai darya mein fana hona. It is my free will. The moment your journey becomes a free will, no compulsion, nobody has forced it onto you, but it is your own growth, then it can bring about a change into you. Ishrate katra hai darya mein fana hona. And the moment the drop that was identified by its own name, it has a form, it has a shape, and then the moment it dissolves, it loses its identity. It is no more recognized as a drop. It loses its form, it loses its name. It is not identified with the name that it is a drop from Thames or Hudson or Nile or Ganges or Sindh or Ravi or any other river. It is, all these things are irrelevant. Now it has only one existence, that it is oceanic. It is part of the ocean. And that oceanic presence, you can call the presence of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala or God, or that is godliness. And in Sufism we use the word baka, means the subsistence in that which is. And then the another thing that happens very clearly, that the ocean lends its form. Ocean is formless, it lends its qualities to the drop. The drop was identified by its taste, name and form. First it becomes formless, it becomes nameless, and it attains the texture of the ocean. You attain the qualities of God. So it is important that godliness is more sublime than God itself. I can reject God at any moment, but I cannot reject godliness. I cannot reject lovingness. I would use the word, let there be lovingness. Let there be godliness. This is quality. The quality is very important. If that quality manifests through your actions, through your life, moment to moment, you are transformed, you are not the same person. And that is the very purpose. You as a form one day, and from form you have attained to formless. You are the meditation is the journey from form to formless, and this is Marakba, you have to wait. When form becomes formless, suddenly you realize the link is no more, you are there, the body is there, but now there exists an infinite abyss between the two. You have to come to know the nature of your body, and you know the body will perish soon, but before it perishes, you have used the vehicle. Suppose you are driving through the vehicle and the vehicle starts giving a problem. You pray that before you reach the destination, you must reach the destination and the vehicle does not shut down. In the same way, your body is a vehicle, and one day it will cease to exist. And if the body does not exist, the light that has been put into you, because it is said, in the beginning God created a humus through the interaction of the soil and the water. Humus is the human aspect, the body was formed, and then he infused the light into it, but the light could not stay because of the darkness inside. Then what he did, he took the light from the forehead of Hazrat Paigambar sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when he put that light into it, it stayed on. So that light is very important, but this light got lost into the wilderness within the body, and body functionings, the mind and the all that is that body brings with it. So now you have to use, before the body disappears, before your vehicle shuts down completely, you must reach your destination. And when you have reached the destination, you can ask someone to take care of it, because you have already reached the destination. You come to know about the nature of the body, it will die soon. But that which is in the body, you know, cannot die. This is an experiment, not a dogma, not a creed. Instead, an experience. Experience in the inner world. Through your various stations, the nafs, the kalb, the ruh, and various stages of nafs, the seven stages of nafs, then the stages of kalb, kalb nilofari, kalb mudabari, kalb sanobari, and the various stages of nafs. When you journey through this, then you realize you are not a creed. This is simply an experiment, not a dogma, not a creed, instead an experience. When meditation happens, you realize the death cannot happen. You will not die, but the body must perish one day. Then no doubt remains, trust arises, but this trust is of a different nature. It is not a conditioned trust that has been imposed on you as faith. This is trust that has evolved out of your own being, out of your own understanding, out of your own experiment. Then no doubt can remain, trust arises, bliss overflows. And to be in trust, is to be blissful, just experiment. With meditation, death vanishes. You experience that which is beyond the death, which is beyond the known, and the life continues. Meditation is an experiment into the inner being, inner realm of the meditator.